Coming up,
Citigroup trademarks thank you and sues at AT&T for thanking clients.
That one sounds crazy, but there's more to it.
It was so crazy, I flubbed saying it.
There you go. Netflix just bought a sci-fi movie. See, I'm flubbing too. Take two. I'm not taking that out. It's great. Netflix just bought a sci-fi movie starring Rooney Mara and Jason Segel, and I have no idea who these people are.
I know who at least one of them are. Courtbacks rules treating internet as utility, not luxury.
Net neutrality. Yay! Lego Dimensions expansion trailer, Harry Potter, Goonies, Gremlins, and more.
Woo! New Star Wars perfumes finally tell us what Jedi are meant to smell like.
That one's rather comical. And sadly, boy snatched by gator is presumed dead. Disney beaches close.
And more on this episode of Watts.
Thank you for joining us once again. This is the Wide Open Talk Show for June 15th, 2016. I'm Donovan Atkisson, and as always, I'm joined by my co-host and good friend, Samuel Lewis. Sam, how has your day been so far?
It's been good. I got to do my job properly and found some mistakes, and that caused some headaches. So it's a 50-50 balance whether, well, I did my job properly, which means I could do it, but oh, now we got to deal with this. So it's weird.
So you were not doing your job properly before, or were you properly?
I was properly doing it. I joked with my aunt over there because she's the one I work with and ride to work with. And I said, well, they decided to be nice to me for the first week and not throw any mistakes. And now they're testing me. So.
Oh, okay. I understand. Yeah. Ah, well, great. Well, it's been raining down here in South Central Georgia. So That's a good thing because it helps to quell the 96 plus degree days that we've been having.
Yeah.
You know, I don't normally do this, but I want to, and this isn't like a, I guess if you look at the actual definition of pet peeve, then it's something that when people routinely do, it irritates you. Okay. This isn't something that I have actually seen done routinely, but it's something that happened today, and I could not believe it. So, my wife and I, we have us a little date today. After she gets off work, I go into town, pick her up, and we go to Applebee's.
Mm-hmm.
So, I carry her back to pick up her vehicle, and she tells me she needs to get gas, and of course, I need to get gas as well. So, I had not at that point decided that I was going to get it. I had like a quarter of a tank. So, and my car gets like 32 to 35 miles per gallon. So I'm good anyway.
Right.
But I found myself on that road. So I'm like, eh, why not? So this is an N mark. So it was like elbow room trying to fight in there, you know, break out the swords and the sabers and everything and what have you to try to get a spot. And I pull in and I start pumping my gas and there's this white vehicle, and you know how this will happen at busy gas stations. People will pull up behind you, and they'll wait for you to finish, and then you pull on out so they can pull up.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm there pumping gas. I had just started pumping gas, and this person had pulled up. And I didn't think anything about it, and suddenly she turns the vehicle off, and this little old lady gets out of the car. She essentially parked behind me. Now, I wasn't blocked in. I could get out. But she parked behind me, got out, and made her way, and I'm not making fun of her because she was slow, but right. Made her way into the N-Mark store, presumably to tell them how much gas she wanted to get. Right. And so I'm thinking, this is a busy damn gas station. I'm about to finish, and I'm going to pull out and of the gas station. Nobody think anything, okay? You dirty rascals. Anyway. I'm going to pull out of the gas station, and this car is going to be awkwardly parked where someone's going to think that they can, if they come in from the other side, that they've got a spot, and then they're going to go nose to nose with this vehicle sitting there.
Mm.
And I'm like, lady, couldn't you have at least waited until I finished and got out of your way, pulled up, and then parked and got out and went inside. At least that way people would know the frickin' stall is occupied. But no, she pulls up behind me, not even straight behind me, kind of at a little angle. It looked crazy. And my wife comes in a little, you know, while I'm pumping, and she sees this, and then of course she has a circle around to find a place to get so that she can get some gas. And she basically said that by the time she finished pumping her gas, that little old lady was finally coming out of the store to come back to her car. I can only imagine the number of people that pulled in that found themselves nose to nose with this vehicle and got pissed. I mean, first world problem, I know, but damn it, be considerate, people. Jeez. You know, don't pull up behind somebody because you know you got to wait in line. You want to be next in line. Let them do their business. Let them get their gas. If you got to go inside because you're not using a credit card or a debit card or anything like that, pull up, park, then go do it. Don't park in some awkward-ass, crazy, I don't know what I could call it, but I don't know why it got under my skin so much, but it did. I'm thinking about this the whole time I'm driving home. I don't mean anything bad about this little old lady, but damn it, what were you thinking?
Feel better?
That rant was brought to you by Slant FM and Aqua. But no, I mean, yeah, I feel better, but I just wanted to share that because I was like, have you ever been in a situation where someone did that? I mean, it didn't personally affect me. But I could imagine how it could have affected me if I'd have been the person to come in and find myself in that situation. I'd have been pissed.
Yeah.
You know, and there are people, that's all it takes. That would have taken them from 0 to 60 road rage, just like that.
Yeah.
So, anyway, hey, this is a call-in show. And the number is 229-518-3525, 229-518-3525. Hey, the switchboard is completely open. You can call in anytime you want to. It's probably going to be a short show unless Sam drones on about video games or something. But anyway, let's get started, shall we? Unless you want to, you have anything else to add to my little tirade?
No, just that I have never seen that done before, so that was a new one on me.
Honestly, I can say that's the first time I've ever seen anybody do it. Because when she walked by me, after she got... I'm sitting there, and I'm pumping gas, and I'm looking at the thing, and then I hear the door go, ka-tunk, and I kind of turn, and this little old, you know, black lady starts walking toward the store, and I just paused, and I'm like, is she doing what I think she's doing? And she keeps making her way to the store, and I turn back, and I look at her car. I look back at her walking to the store, and I'm like, yep, she's doing exactly what I thought she was doing. Okay, all right. Talk about other frivolous, stupid crap. Citigroup has trademarked thank you, as in the word thank you, altogether, and then they have sued AT&T for AT&T thanking their clients. Now, okay, Ars Technica, I like you, but this headline is a little misleading.
It's
a little sensationalized. What it comes down to is Citigroup has a trademark on using the word, and I think this is a little ridiculous. I mean, it's kind of like Microsoft wanting to trademark the word Windows back in the day.
Yeah.
You know. The thing is, for anybody that doesn't understand what trademark is actually for, trademark is so that you can prevent confusion, brand confusion, in the mind of the consumer. So in the instance of Microsoft, you know, their operating system is called Windows, so they wanted to trademark Windows. Well, the problem is... there's no confusion in the mind of the consumer. If you're talking about Windows and you're mentioning it in context with computers versus Windows in context of a house or an office building or anything like that, there's absolutely no need to trademark it. because everybody knows, they either say it's Microsoft Windows or, yeah, I run Windows on my computer. Immediately know what that is. So Citigroup, at some point, has got several trademarks, one of them being the word thank you all put together. They have another one that actually says something like thanks, and it has their Citi logo on it.
Yeah.
Well, AT&T also has started this like loyalty program, and they are essentially doing a thank you. And let's see. I want to find the actual lawsuit. Yep, let's bring this up because, and I have to give credit to the producer because he's the one that actually dug into this and let me know that it was not as cut and dry as I thought it was. All right, so
he sort of curries things like this.
yeah, he does. All right, so what it says is, Citigroup's thank you customer loyalty programs and marks. For many years, Citigroup has used trademarks consisting of and or containing the term thank you, including thank you, comma, Citi thank you, comma, Citi business thank you from Citi, and thank you your way. And keep in mind, every time I say thank you, that is one word. It is not the standard thank space you. In connection with a variety of customer loyalty, reward, incentive, and redemption programs, collectively, the thank you marks. They give an example of what they do with the branded credit card, blah, 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 blah. Then they got a list of all of the marks when they were done. The first thank you mark was filed in 2004. Citi thank you was filed in 2007. Another thank you was filed in 2010. Blah, blah, blah. Then we got the one, the actual one where it says thank you from Citi, and it was done in 2013. Thank you your way was done in 2013. So yeah, they've got that. Then they've got AT&T's history of collaboration with Citigroup. Citigroup has partnered and continues to partner with AT&T in connection with the promotion of Citigroup's thank you customer loyalty, reward, and redemption programs. For example, customers of the AT&T Universal Card can earn thank you points through Citigroup's thank you program based on money spent on purchases made with their card. AT&T uses its trademark along Citigroup's trademarks, including Citigroup's thank you trademark, in connection with its advertising and promotion of the AT&T Universal Card. And then attached as Exhibit B is a page from their website regarding the AT&T Universal Card, et cetera, et cetera. Since at least as early as 98, Citigroup and AT&T have issued co-branded credit cards. In or around 98, they launched the Universal Card. Okay, here we go. AT&T's adoption of the thanks in small letters and AT&T thanks with the word thanks in small letters. In late March of 2016, Citigroup became aware of AT&T's purported intent to use the AT&T Thanks trademark. Shortly thereafter, Citigroup contacted AT&T to express its concern that the proposed AT&T Thanks trademark was confusingly similar to Citigroup's thank you marks. On April 7th of 2016, after it was aware of Citigroup's concern about its use of the AT&T Thanks trademark, AT&T Intellectual Property 2 LP filed an application with the USPTO to register the trademark AT&T Thanks in connection with providing incentive award programs for customers for the purpose of promoting and rewarding loyalty on an intent-to-use basis, the AT&T Thanks application. Print out of the information regarding the AT&T, blah, 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 blah. So after AT&T filed the AT&T Thanks application, Citigroup and AT&T exchanged letters and engaged in additional telephone discussions regarding AT&T's planned use of the AT&T Thanks mark. Citigroup again expressed its concern that its proposed AT&T Thanks mark was confusingly similar to Citigroup's thank you marks, particularly in light of the similarity between the services identified in the AT&T Thanks application and Citigroup's thank you loyalty, reward, and redemption programs. While the parties were trying to resolve this matter, AT&T basically gave Citigroup the big FU and launched a customer appreciation program using the Thanks and AT&T Thanks trademarks. So, June 2nd, AT&T Incorporated issued a press release announcing the launch of AT&T Thanks, which it describes as an appreciation program for its customers. The press release describes several entertainment benefits that will be available to AT&T customers in the summer of 2016 and states that surprise offers and offers tailored to customers based on their services and packages with AT&T would be provided at a later date. And they give
This is them responding to T-Mobile, by the way, on a side note. That's totally what's going on.
Yeah, right? That's exactly what it is. So on June 2nd, 2016, they posted a page on the website describing the launch, and it uses, for our video viewers, you can see it right here. It says AT&T Thanks. And Thanks is under the AT&T with in all small letters. So notably in the logo used by AT&T, the term Thanks appears on a different line and in a different color than AT&T housemark. The use of all lowercase letters and the font in which the term thanks is written are similar to the manner in which Citigroup often presents its thank you marks. So, Citigroup basically turned around and sued AT&T and said, look, you're violating our trademark. You're causing us damage. You're going to cause us potential damage. I don't know if there's actually any money mentioned in this so far.
Right.
But honestly, from what we've seen here, could either one of us honestly get confused on the AT&T Thanks loyalty program versus the Citigroup Thank You loyalty program?
Not really. I mean, heck, I'd probably have problems remembering what the loyalty program was called and probably say, yeah, you know that loyalty program that AT&T runs or something like that, right?
Yeah. So, I understand trying to protect your brand.
Right.
I understand the purpose of trademarks. Like I said, the entire thing wrapped in a nutshell is we want to ensure that a phrase, a word, a logo, whatever, because you've got service marks and trademarks, that is identifiable to, I mean, it's like Netflix. You know, if you and I started a service and we called it Samflix, I'm not going to tell you what kind of content it would be. Bow, chicka, wow, wow. Anyway, but if we started Samflix and we did your logo in the exact same font and coloration as Netflix, we would get sued because that right there would make some people look and go, has Netflix done something new? Is this a new service they're offering? Mm-hmm. That makes all kinds of sense to me.
Totally.
But this right here is just absolutely ludicrous.
Mm.
And I don't mean the singer. So, yeah, I mean, yay for frivolous lawsuits. Yay for taking up the court's time. Yay for spending millions and millions of dollars so that you can turn around and raise our frickin' cellular rates.
That gives us something to talk about.
I guess so. Okay. Moving on.
Mm.
I'm pissed enough. Netflix just bought a sci-fi movie starring Rooney Mara and Jason Segel. All right, you said you know one of these. You know who is it, Rooney or Jason?
Jason Segel.
Who the heck is Jason Segel?
He was in How I Met Your Mother. He was the male lead in the first Muppets movie whenever they got resurrected, things like that. So,
sweet guy. Okay. I guess I could have just looked him up.
You could have. Where's the fun in that?
IMDb.com.
If I'm thinking the right person, watch me be completely wrong and actually.
Jason Segel. Yeah, actor. How I Met Your Mother. Oh, that goofy looking dude.
Yep.
Nah, he's all right. He's all right. Looks a little fat in this one picture right here, but otherwise, he's all right.
Yep.
Dang, he's a youngster. He was only born in 1980. Oh, wow. Hey, by the way,
yeah.
How was your birthday?
Oh, it was good. It was a good day. It's normally the days when you have to work during your birthday. You're kind of like, eh. I mean, for me, it's another day, right?
Yeah. But, well, cool.
But various things were peppered throughout the day that people did that just made me smile the whole day. So, yeah.
Well, I wished you a happy birthday. So there, that's the most important thing.
That was part of it.
You're not going to take that away from me. All right. So anyway, Netflix is making an exciting addition. I don't know why I said it that way. To its growing lineup of original films by purchasing The Discovery. This one actually piqued my curiosity because you want to know why?
Why?
I'm about to tell you. Anyway, it's a new movie from writer-director Charlie McDowell that's going to, and I don't know who that is, so, you know, kudos to Charlie McDowell, that's going to explore the consequences of an afterlife whose existence has been scientifically proven.
You have my attention. Because yes. I hadn't heard about this until we started reading this.
Deadline is reporting the streaming service has purchased the global right to the movie, rights to the movie, which is going to premiere on Netflix and enjoy a brief run in domestic theaters next year. Rooney Mara and Jason Segel are going to play the couple at the movie center. Robert Redford will play Segel's father, the man responsible for discovering the afterlife.
Nice.
So, yeah. I'm definitely intrigued. It's an entertaining and interesting ideology to be able to say, yes, we have just scientifically proven that there's an afterlife.
Yeah, right.
You don't really want to know what the dudes on the other side are really like, but anyway, that was a joke, Sam.
Yep. Well, I was thinking about that. I took it a bit seriously for a second, not offended or anything. I was like, no, man, that could be a slant on it. What if it wasn't exactly? Anyway, I'm thinking of plot points that they could possibly put into this now. My brain's just racing. It's beautiful.
So in terms of the pedigree, it's an acquisition that is more in common with Netflix recent indie purchases and Sundance buying spree than its ballyhooed Adam Sandler deal, which I would never... Look, I have nothing against Sandler, however you say his name.
Yeah.
But basically, all of the last five movies that he's done has been complete crap or something like that.
If you don't count the Hotel Transylvania movies, which were apparently good, and I really don't count those in Sandler's things because I think someone else was in charge of those. He was just a voice.
Yeah.
But yeah, pretty much. Mm. There are people in my household that will disagree with you on that point, but at least we agree.
I've never really liked him as an actor. The last movie that I really saw was, what's the name of that one that he played opposite of, oh God, what's her name?
Bah, bah, bah. 50 First Dates.
Where she couldn't remember everything and the next day?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that one was okay, but, you know, some of these, like USA or TNT or one of the, they get on this kick where they'll play a movie like that five times in a week.
Yeah.
And then they'll do that for 4 weeks. And I'm like, you know what? This movie was good the first, maybe second time I saw bits and pieces of it. But now I'm about to go kill somebody. Stop playing this thing, please.
Mm. Well, this was the one that a bunch of Native Americans walked off set, wasn't it? Because they had their...
There was one. I don't remember which one it was. It was... because he had some derogatory jokes in the script or what have you toward Native Americans. And I don't remember what the title of that one was, but
right.
I do remember there was a controversy. And I think it was last year. It was either 2015 or 2014. I can't remember. You know, when you get to my age, all the years start blurring together.
It's happening at my age, so don't worry about it.
Yes! So it's early, but The Discovery can boast a fascinating premise and a compelling cast. It's easy to understand why Netflix is excited about it. Quote, "To describe the story as original doesn't begin to capture the world that Charlie has created," said Netflix Chief Content Officer Ted Sarandos to Deadline. "Our global viewers are gonna love this film."
Netflix is just working on actually making me subscribe, because I currently still do not have Netflix around here. But with all the Marvel stuff they're doing, the fact that they're getting ready to do a series of unfortunate events series, which I think is going to be dang good, especially considering they've got Neil Patrick Harris playing Count Olaf, which is like, yes, yes. You know, as they rebooted the Magic School Bus and Inspector Gadget and stuff like that. I mean, they're just making stuff going, come on, Samuel, you know, you want to. It's like, now I have money coming in. I can't give you the excuse I used to give you. So we'll see. We'll see. They might get us in yet.
Netflix is one of those services that I have found that when there is something on there that I really want to watch, I'm glad that I have it.
Mm.
But I would have to almost say that 8 months out of the 12 months of the year, I'm paying for something that I don't even use.
Yeah. That's kind of what I'm afraid I would be doing too.
Yeah.
So, because I'm even curious about some of their originals, like House of Cards and stuff like that.
Oh,
I'm
yeah.
actually pretty curious about.
See, I've never watched that. I don't really care to watch it. But then again, I'm finding that there are shows in the past that I'm like, I don't really want to watch that. And then suddenly it's like, I'm curious. Let's go watch that.
Totally.
The matter of fact, the last couple of days, it occurred to me that Lee and I had never actually watched the the last season of Haven, which was on Sci-Fi. Ah. We had watched season 5 up to about episode 5, and there was just something about the way the storyline was going that we were like, okay, we're checking out. You know, just sometimes that happens in a show. I don't know why.
Yeah.
It's just like you may really like the show. It starts out really well. It may bog down in the middle a little bit, but you stick with it. And you get into the very end. You know this is last season. It's like, I'm done. We did the same thing with The Dome. We watched the first two seasons of The Dome. I don't give a crap about the last season. I just... Because it
should have only been one season until they got rid of all the book premise and just stretched it out. That's why.
True. Very true. So I was like, hey, I bet you it's on Netflix. So I go to Netflix and I'm like, hey, 1 through 5 seasons. All right. So I'm scrolling through the episodes in the 5th season. I'm like, I don't see William Shatner here because William Shatner stars in like the last 3 or 4 episodes of Haven.
Mm.
And then I go to my go-to whenever I want to know something about television shows called thetvdb.com. Right. I look it up and I discover, wait a minute, there's 26 episodes in season 5. Netflix has 13.
Mm.
They don't have the rest of season 5.
Wow.
So then I'm like, okay, I got Hulu. So I go to Hulu and I pull it up. And Hulu has this bad habit, and it's not their fault. It's this dumbass streaming rights crap that I'll never understand. It's artificial, and these programmers just need to get off their butts and figure out that if you give the public what they want and you make it easy for them, they will throw money at you like women throwing their panties at Justin Bieber or somebody. That's probably not a good analogy. But anyway...
Yeah.
I couldn't think of anybody else, okay?
I couldn't think of the actor that does Magic Mike, or that would have been a pretty...
Yeah, God. Because he's actually supposed to be playing the Raging Cajun. But anyway, which that movie looks like it's in dire straits and probably is never going to get made. This is the episode where we go all over the map. Where was I? I got completely sidetracked.
Streaming rights.
Oh, streaming rights. Yes. All right. So I go to Hulu. I find Haven. Well, they have the last 5 episodes of season 5. And this happens a lot. So even if you do pay for Hulu, whether it's the $7.99 or $11.99, because $11.99 lets you get it without commercials, with the exception of certain episodes where at the very beginning it says, due to streaming rights, this one does not fall under our blah, 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 commercial free, blah, blah, blah. So there's going to be a commercial at the beginning and the end. I'm like, you're going to make me sit through the one at the beginning, but you're not making me sit through the one at the end. So there, I win anyway. But point is, they do all that crap. And several of it. So you think, okay, I can skip a few episodes, right? Oh, no, 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 no. You skip too many, like you skip 6, now you can't go back and get the very first one that you missed. So it's done this way on certain shows. Okay.
Yeah.
I know I'm drawing out here, but so I find Haven, last five episodes, I'm like, okay, this means I'm going to have to go the alternate route. But at least I'll get to watch the last five episodes of this in crystal clear 720p with closed captioning. And then I get to noticing this show is not available on your to be streamed to your television or external device, meaning you can only watch it on the website on your computer. And there again, it's due to streaming rights from Sci-Fi and NBC Universal.
It's ridiculous.
So, this is not directed at you, Sam, but this is directed to NBC Universal and all of the people out there that do these dumbass streaming rights things. Here's the finger. All right. So, it's crap.
Yeah.
You know, totally is. As far as we've gotten in our streaming and being able to have access to all this content, there are still sections of Netflix and Hulu and all these other things that feel so backwoodsy, it's pathetic.
Mm-hmm.
And that right there is it. I can't get all of the episodes of I'm paying for Netflix. I got access to seasons 1 through 5.5 of Haven. But I can't get the, I don't know when. Nothing on there tells me when they're going to have the other episodes.
Yeah.
They force people into doing things that they don't want people to do.
Oatmealing is still alive.
Yep. Anyway, so talking about that, let's segue into this, and this has to do with net neutrality. Mm. All right, so we know that Obama told the FCC, hey, we need you really need to put the internet up under Title II so that you can actually regulate this. And then the cable companies can't do this crap about, oh, hey, Netflix, if you pay me a little bit of money, we'll make sure that, you know, all of our customers get to you priority number one. Oh, you're not going to pay? Oh, I'm so sorry.
You know, these are some lovely bandwidth cables. It'd be a shame if they got congested all of a sudden. You know what I'm saying?
That's it. So all of these companies sued. And it wound up in federal court. So yesterday or day before, I think it was yesterday, the federal court has ruled in a sweeping decision that it is a utility. They have upheld, it was a 2-1 decision from a 3-judge panel at the United States Court of Appeals for the District of Columbia Circuit on Tuesday, came in a case about rules applying to a doctrine known as net neutrality, which prohibits broadband companies from blocking or slowing the delivery of internet content to consumers. So, yes, we have won. Of course, all of these communication companies, ISPs, or what have you, have vowed to appeal. AT&T immediately said it's going to continue to fight.
Yep.
Quote, we have always expected this issue to be decided by the Supreme Court, and we look forward to participating in that appeal, said David McAtee II, the Senior Executive Vice President and General Counsel for AT&T.
If ever there was a lawyer name, by the way, that would be one of them.
That right there is a $150,000 last name, if I've ever seen one. So, for now, the decision limits the ability of broadband providers like Comcast, Verizon, to shape the experience of the internet users, meaning they can't slow it down. And, well, legally, they can't slow it down.
Right.
I can tell you, as a former cable executive, there are things that can be done in a cable system that cannot be found that will piss your customers off on why stuff is slow. I mean, you can traffic shape, you know, like BitTorrent and things like that. And, you know, and the sad thing about doing something like that is BitTorrent actually has legitimate legal uses.
Yep.
The BattleNet application that lets you update your Blizzard games like Hearthstone and World of Warcraft and now I started to say Overcast. Overwatch. That uses a BitTorrent technology, peer-to-peer.
Mm.
So, yeah, there's some things that can be done. But if you could ever prove right now, if you could ever prove that your cable company was slowing you down from getting to Netflix or bringing content in from Netflix or Hulu or whatever, especially, like is always brought up, in without net neutrality, they could try to get Hulu or Netflix to do this deal, and if Netflix and Hulu don't want to do this deal, and then Comcast or Verizon launches a competing service, and it's like, wow, we get uninterrupted streams, superior quality, and everything from Verizon's streaming service, which cost us $35 a month. But every time I try to use my $9 Netflix, it buffers. Yeah, that's what you get without net neutrality.
Yeah.
So far, as it is now, we've won, but the battle's not over.
By the way, remember whenever, because this picture of Tom Wheeler reminds me, I think we need to say something. I think the internet as a whole owes Tom Wheeler an apology. Because do you remember when we first got in, what all of us thought was going to happen?
Vaguely.
We all thought he was going to be such a shill for the companies and everything that we'd be screwed over. And he's done the exact opposite. It's been insane.
Yeah, because he's actually a former cable executive, right?
Yeah,
yeah,
that's what it was. He was part of that system, and we all seemed, oh, great, now they got a guy in. And sure enough, he has proven all of us wrong. So apologies, Tom Wheeler. We said the wrong things about you.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. Maybe he realized once he got away from that, he's like, you know what they're saying? That crap's true.
Yeah.
I know exactly how these companies act because I used to do it.
I've seen stuff, man. You have no idea.
Yeah, that's it. You don't want to go there. Okay. This is going to be yours because I know nothing about this.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's not like I have personal skin in the game whatsoever. Look at that proton pack. Look at it.
Yes, and for our audio listeners, Sam is holding up, what do you call these things?
Lego Dimensions, so they're minifigures.
Okay.
Little Lego minifigures on RFID tags that are read by the platform that you put them on.
All right.
So, it's got all the kit. Pretty much, like, I'm holding up the Doctor right now. This is just a minifigure. This is the thing that it actually reads and takes care of everything on. They've just got it presented as a minifigure to put on top of it. That way, it's a physical object. So yeah.
Now
it's
my
bunch of RFID tags.
Okay, so my question is this: what's the purpose of having that little RFID tag? I mean, I play a video game with a controller. I don't play it with a little dude sitting next to me. Well, I used to. He was called Devin, but
right, yeah, totally right. So the point of the RFID is, well, it proves that you have this. For instance, in the case of the Doctor, he was part of what was called a level pack. So whenever you would plop this little guy down, it would automatically unlock the character, so you can use the character now. And in fact, unless the character is on the platform itself, you're not using him because he's not in game, right? So
you can have the character, but he's not actually in the game yet.
He's in the game, but as soon as you put him on the platform, then you can use him. You can physically use the character.
Okay.
So it's not like you've got all your characters running around, because if that were the case, I'd have a full screen the whole time. But say I want to use the Doctor for this level, plop him down, and then you're able to switch to him and use him.
Oh,
that's pretty much how it works.
Okay.
And different Lego characters, because all the Lego games have always done this, different Lego characters have different abilities, things they can do that other characters can't do, and stuff like that. Like the Doctor can use his sonic screwdriver to shatter glass. He can fix things, and he can use hacking panels as well. So that's the things he can specifically do, for instance. So there's a bunch of things like that. So then they just took the whole idea of Lego games, as they always went, and applied it to a physical object into digital space sort of framework.
Okay, so there's some kind of thing that you hook up to your game console that you set these things, these miniature figures on?
Mm-hmm. If it wasn't plugged to the 360, I would actually go ahead and pick it up and show you that. But that might end badly, considering it's built out of Legos too. I mean, the base isn't, but you do build the little portal around it out of Legos, which was a nice touch, I thought.
Okay, I always wondered what that was whenever you've shown it before, and I'm like, okay, that looks elaborate. I don't really understand what that is, but...
Mm. Yeah, that's the platform that you put it on. The platform even has little LEDs built into it, which comes into certain game mechanics you play it with and everything. It's mm-hmm. really neat how they've done it. They've made that thing to where it's not just a place you put the figures and that's it. You know, something like Skylanders or stuff like that, or Amiibos. They've actually made it to where it's a game mechanic. It matters where those characters are on that panel, depending on when you're doing certain things. So yeah, they've made it more detailed than just plop the stuff down and that's all it does. Sort of thing.
Okay. So I was wondering because I knew or I had heard about these other things. So they're not all created equal is what you're saying.
I'm saying that. Yeah. I mean, Nintendo does a pretty good job with their Amiibos of having them unlock things in games, but I don't think I would ever, I especially wouldn't get Disney Infinity considering it got canceled. Right.
Right.
But, well, which yeah. is something I'm going to bring up later. But Skylanders never appealed to me or anything like that. Lego Dimensions was the first one that made me go, okay, fine. Fine. One of these games finally got me. And I'm happy to say I am not disappointed. Me and Mom have played through the main story, although it hasn't all been released yet. But we've played through the main story and really enjoyed it. We just recently got the Ghostbusters one. So we're currently playing through that again. You guys will catch up eventually. But it's pretty good. The boss battle glitched out on us, which was an unfortunate thing, so we had to fix that. But it might have been because I might have been shortcutting the boss battle based on the fact I had upgraded the DeLorean to shoot electricity. But anyway, that's beside the point.
Not trying to game the system, are you now?
Well, if you give something a power and it's going to activate a coil, don't expect me not to use it.
Okay, fair enough.
But it apparently didn't like that. So anyway, this news that's coming out is that because there was a worry. There was a genuine worry, at least on my end, that, well, we've just got these initial waves of LEGO Dimensions that have come out. And then after that, we're not going to have any more. That's not the case. In fact, the trailer that Donovan's playing right now will show off some of this stuff while I'm talking. But they've announced a bunch of new characters that are coming into the game. So you've got things like the new Ghostbusters, Harry Potter is finally showing up. It's all these, some of these we expected, right? Because LEGO already had these licenses. They just didn't put them in Dimensions, or at least not yet.
Mm-hmm.
And then we get some that are just downright, holy crap, how'd you even get that license, right? So let me give you guys a rundown of all the new stuff that's coming to LEGO's Dimensions, because thanks to the Slash Film article, they've given us all the stuff. So we have Adventure Time. Okay, makes sense. I think there's even some actual Adventure Time LEGO sets, if I'm not mistaken. I've never played Adventure Time, or I've never watched Adventure Time. It's something I meant to give a chance. But the A-Team is going to be in this game, or at least B.A. Baracus in the van. Now, it's going to be a fun pack. I'll explain that later. Beetlejuice, E.T., Fantastic Beast and Where to Find Them, the new Ghostbusters, the Goonies, Gremlins, Harry Potter, the Lego Batman movie, Lego City Undercover, which was another game that they did, Knight Rider, Mission Impossible, and we're not talking classic Mission Impossible, we are talking Tom Cruise, the Powerpuff Girls, Sonic the Hedgehog, and Teen Titans Go. All of these things have been announced to be placed inside of LEGO Dimensions, this being included with things like Back to the Future, some other ones, Lord of the Rings.
Yeah, I saw Gollum.
Yeah, Jurassic World. There's a
Sonic
whole bunch
the Hedgehog.
Of,
I saw that one.
Yeah, he's one of the new ones that gets added too.
Yeah.
But yeah, they've got all these properties. Now all of these are not going to be levels, apparently. Yeah, of course, Doctor Who's in this game. That was a big... The way they utilize the Doctor in the story, it's beautiful. Let me put it that way. They didn't hold back thinking, well, maybe some of these American people might not know. No, they just went full hog. They didn't care. They were like, we're dealing with dimensional portals. Who's the character that we have that's most qualified to deal with this? Ah, the Doctor. Yes, he's going to deal with this. You know, and they didn't care if anyone wasn't going to know who he was. It was beautiful. It was inspired. And they pretty much did that with all the characters. You know, if they were qualified for something, they were definitely going to take care of it. But yeah, so the way that this is going to work is that there are different type of packs that Lego Dimensions has. So you have fun packs where they're just a character and a vehicle usually. So like B.A. Baracus with the van is going to be a fun pack. Fun packs don't come with levels. They're just now you have the character in game to use if you want.
Okay.
There are level packs, which add a new level, a new story-based level to the game where it's something that doesn't really deal with the main Lego Dimensions story, but is a fun little thing. Like you got to do an adventure, one of the Doctor's adventures for the Doctor Who one, where it was him roaming around inside of the TARDIS, rebuilding K-9 and stuff like that. So it's things like that where it was little standalone stories. Some of them, like the Back to the Future and Ghostbusters ones, were based on the movies themselves, and it was you playing through well-known scenes built out of Lego, you know, and things like that. But other ones, like the Doctor Who, was a completely original story that had never been told before with Peter Capaldi voicing the Doctor, right? So you've got those things. Those are level packs where you get a brand new level, you play all the way through it, mm-hmm. and do it that way. That usually comes with three things: a main minifigure, a weapon or vehicle of some sort, and another vehicle. So you're definitely going to have at least one vehicle and either another vehicle or an object or stuff. There's team packs where it's usually two minifigures and two vehicles of some sort. Like the Jurassic World one was Owen, I think his name, the one that... Star-Lord played for some reason. Chris Pratt, there we go.
Yeah, okay.
So I have a little minifigure of Chris Pratt. and his character's thing that he gets to ride upon is a raptor. So there's a little Lego raptor that I have too. And then there's an officer from the park and the little gyrosphere thing that they drove around in.
Mm-hmm.
I've got one of those. So that was a team pack where it's four things. But now they're releasing brand new packs called story packs. And the way these are going to work, the first one that they're going to do is going to be the new Ghostbusters. And the way it's going to pan out, apparently, is that a story pack is a pack of multiple levels that are based around these things that is actually going to connect with the Lego Dimensions storyline. I'm not going to say much about it because it could spoil something for someone that hasn't played this game, or people that are watching the Let's Plays right now. But the point is that the story is continuing through these story packs, and apparently they're also going to do this with Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them. Is another thing that they're going to do a story pack for. So in other words, these things are epic enough that they're just creating large chunks of game instead of just one level.
Mm-hmm.
This is just insane. The fact that Lego has all of these properties is something that I never thought would happen. It's one of those things where you've got all these different people owning all these different properties, and to have a game go, oh no, yeah, we get to put all of these in here and they get to interact and everything. It's just insane to me.
Well, I can imagine that all of these various production companies that hold the rights to these things see this as just a win-win for them, because it gets these characters. I mean, apparently this is a very successful game as far as this Lego Dimensions is concerned. I mean, it seems to be very successful. So why not just, you know, it makes sense. License it, get it in there, get it into the keep it in the mindset of the game players, and especially. I guess you could argue this, that this is not necessarily... What age group is this stuff targeted for? Because, I mean, you're an old man now, so, I mean, what are you doing playing? No, I'm kidding.
Thing is, with Lego games, I would consider them aimed at younger people, but then some of the properties that they have gotten a hold of, I'm not so sure anymore, mm-hmm. right? It's almost like they've realized, oh, holy crap, adults really like this too. Get some more stuff, right? And so they are. I mean, they got a license with Midway. There is a level that will come up in our Let's Plays where it was us playing through a bunch of Midway games built out of Lego. It was a whole 8-bit world. In fact, we just started it last week. In fact, I remember in you guys' timeline, the people that are watching. So... some of them are just really weird, and me and Mom have been having a blast playing this game. She is almost obsessed with this game, okay? She almost likes it even more than I do, okay?
Yeah, so I've caught a few of them because I try to. I'm probably behind, but I try to add them to our playlist that replays on our live page, so that if anybody drives up to it, they have a chance of, you know, seeing you and your mom playing this. So, but she seems to get tickled playing this stuff.
Oh yeah, and we geek out like crazy just the combinations. I mean, I got to team up with the Ghostbusters to take down General Zod, okay? That's a sentence I never thought I would be able to say, and yet I got to. The Riddler on the back of a Balrog, let's put it that way. It's just beautiful, the stuff that happens in this game.
Okay,
it's
so
insane.
So for clarity's sake, you did not snap Zod's neck, right?
No.
Okay. No. That's a throwback to the Man of Steel movie. Anyway,
yeah, totally. But yeah, we just have a blast with this, and I'm excited that they are going to carry on with this, because that was the one worry of, oh, they got all these properties. There's no way this is getting expanded any further. And sure enough, I was wrong. So there you go.
Yeah, it looks like they added a ton of new characters, and I mean, I can see that, and I don't even play it.
Yeah, totally.
I do have an Xbox 360, but I can't get into this, because if I do and I find that I like it, there's a job, needing to make money, play game. Yeah, no. I mean,
me and mom split it. That's how we've been getting through this.
I don't know. My wife might actually enjoy this. I mean, it's hard to say, but
It's not a hard-to-play game, he says, knowing full well that there are times he's had to, rather frustratingly to the bemusement of the audience, get a bit grumpy at his mother, saying, no, go there! Go! No, not over there! Go over there, dang it! The portal levels were some of the most frustrating things me and her have ever gone through in our entire lives, and she will say that. And just, whenever we got to the main story where there was going to be portal levels again, she was like, oh, no.
You know, I fully expect her one day, you're going to do that, and she's going to look at you and go, you know, I brought you into this world. I can take you out.
We've had this exchange that I've said, and you'd miss me. And she said, oh, yes, I would. So,
but not for the first 5 minutes.
Yeah, totally right.
Oh. Okay, so you're going to go in debt trying to get all of these. Is that what you're saying?
Not all of them. Not all of them have my attention. Like Adventure Time, meh. Teen Titans Go, meh. Maybe the Powerpuff Girls, if they go with the classic Powerpuff Girls as opposed to what apparently is the Atrocity, which has currently been the rebooted Powerpuff Girls. But otherwise, it's one of those things. So, but most of the other ones, like, yeah, I suspect that I will be getting these. I might have a bit more self-control with team packs and not get those, but level packs? Oh, yeah, it's happening.
Well, good deal. And this was all announced at E3,
mm-hmm.
which is going on. Is today like the last? No, it lasts all week, doesn't it?
It does. The press conferences are done with, but there's still announcements and stuff like that coming out. So,
yeah,
but yeah, this got announced at E3, and apparently the things are going to start hitting shelves September the 27th with the Ghostbusters Story Pack, Adventure Time and Mission Impossible Level Packs, Harry Potter and Adventure Time Team Packs, and the A-Team Fun Pack. And the rest of the expansions will be coming in through waves like they did the original ones throughout the summer, which of course is fantastic to me and mom because we don't have to buy them all at once.
Well, good deal.
Yeah.
That's just more of a fuel for the fire of your Let's Play. So
exactly. That was the other thing me and mom talked about. It's like, we got more stuff to play for. So.
They'll never end. Oh, my God. They will never. I mean, they'll never end. Yeah.
Well, Mr. Never played Zelda before. At some point, whenever we get through the current run of Lego Dimensions, you can watch one of those if you want.
You know, I saw them actually announced the new Zelda game, and I've seen.
Oh God,
I've
it's
seen
beautiful.
It does. It actually. I've never seen a game designed in that style. I don't know what that style is, but
cell shading. They did it with The Legend of Zelda: Wind Waker back in the day.
I mean, I've seen cell shading before. It looks. I didn't think that's what it was, but maybe it is. It looks really glowy though.
That looks hybrid cell shaded. It's almost like it's 3D and cell shaded at the same time.
Maybe
that makes sense.
That's what it is. I think that's what it is. Because I have played some cel-shaded games before. Yeah, and that one, I just looked at it and went, it's purdy.
But they've even talked about things that have never been in Zelda games, like in order to restore health, you're going to have to eat food.
I saw that. And now your weapons actually can suffer damage.
I know, which is the one thing that I was like, oh, God, I'm going to be inappropriately swearing at this at some point. I know. I'm going to be fighting this huge boss and suddenly, dang it, my sword just broke.
Katink. Oh, crap. Yeah, there was a segment of my life, you know, video game wise, where I didn't do anything. How old am I? 46. yeah. You know, I was in that first wave, the Atari 2600, then I had a Commodore 64. I was in, I had a ColecoVision, which to me actually had better graphics than the Atari. I played the crap out of some Ladybug, which was basically a ripoff of Pac-Man, but anyway. And then the video game market crashed, and I didn't do anything. I had no clue what a Nintendo was.
Right.
When it came out. I didn't know what any of this stuff that the video game industry had basically kind of rebirthed and until the Super NES came out. And I was like, wait, what is all this stuff? And then the Sega Genesis came out, and that was probably the first gaming console that I bought myself. And I mean, I went all out, went to Sears. Spent $600 on the Sears card, bought everything for the Sega Genesis. And but my thing's always been mainly PC games.
Yeah.
And now, I mean, we got the N64, the GameCube, then Devin got a PlayStation 1. I think he got a PlayStation. No, he got a PlayStation 2. I forget anyway.
Yeah.
So
they start to blend together at some point.
They do. So that entire time where the whole Zelda stuff happened, I was completely out of playing video games. That's the reason why I never played it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't really start seriously playing video games until Half-Life came out in 97, 98, and that game scared the crap out of me. and then I was playing some of the first MMORPGs even before World of Warcraft came out. But then whenever WoW came out, that was it. I was done. I was in it for almost, I wouldn't say 10 years because 10 years would, well, no, pretty much off and on for 10 years. So I think I played some back in January, but otherwise it's been a little bit of Hearthstone, a little bit of Overwatch, a little bit of Heroes of the Storm. So me know nothing about Zelda other than what my kids tell me. Or you tell me.
Yeah.
So.
Like I said, if you ever wanted to jump in on one, I would probably, weirdly enough, I think you'd like Majora's Mask, but that's, anyway. It happens to be my favorite. I'm not partial at all.
Not partial at all. Yeah. All right, one last fun story before we talk about a tragedy, but new Star Wars perfumes finally tell us what Jedi are meant to smell like. Yeah. So they have actually come out with a new line of perfume in Europe that comes in Jedi, Empire, and Queen Amidala fragrances, complete with lightsaber-inspired bottles.
And now I was looking at these bottles. These are some pretty sweet bottles, not going to lie.
Honestly, when I first saw it, I mistook them for a dildo. But
It could be.
Yeah, and that's not to say that somebody won't try that, but...
Unfortunately.
Yeah. All right, so it says... How do you bottle up religious cults, horrifying dictatorships, and an elected monarch into smells? So, according to German-based perfumery, I guess that's how you say it, lifestyle perfumes, it involves a large quantity of citrus fruits, which features in all three of the theme fragrances. So, here's the breakdown. The Jedi, let's see, head, heart, and base. The head is mandarin, pink, pepper, yep. Black pepper. The heart is water lily. The base is patchouli,
yeah,
sandalwood, amber, and musk. So then, if you want Empire, you've got bergamot, lemon, lime, apple, cardamom, clove, jasmine, amber, patchouli, sandalwood, and tonka bean. But they don't have any specifics on Amidala, just a picture that features oranges, chocolates, and vanilla, and presumably not the smell of whatever those big bulbous space cows she and Anakin were rolling around with on Naboo were called in Attack of the Clones. So if you like Star Wars and smelling nice and you're European, go get some. And I like this one commenter. I'm guessing the Jabba the Hutt fragrance was shelved.
Wow, yes.
Here, Jabba the Hutt, new perfume, smells like funk. Okay. So this weekend, unfortunately, has been,
yeah.
The Orlando thing, the singer, Grammy. You know, her being basically assassinated, if you will, Friday.
Right.
So then the one place that you think you would be safe is Disney World. But not, apparently, no. Let me bring up this other thing, because there is a, I was thinking there's a map on this one. Maybe it was on the other one. Anyway. Down there at their resort, it's around, I'm trying to find this thing. There's this place, it's a man-made lagoon or a man-made lake called Seven Seas Lagoon.
Yeah.
So you've got this family that's been down there, they're vacationing, and they got a four-year-old and a two-year-old, and a two-year-old, I mean, it's like a beach area, so a two-year-old's doing what a two-year-old's going to do. Go out, play a little in, you know, the edge of the water or what have you. And, of course, you know, this is not a commentary on the parents because these parents have suffered enough. Kind of the same sentiment that Philip said today in his show.
And they even tried to rescue the boy and failed.
Right, right.
So it's not like they did nothing. Right?
Some other information that my wife was telling me about that some coworkers of hers had told her was, and I hadn't found this, so, I mean, I'm taking her at her word that of what they told her was right. That the child was actually 20 feet in, like 10 to 20 feet in, that he had been at the edge of the water, but had actually come back in, and the alligator actually came out of the water, grabbed him, and went back in. I mean, either way, it's tragic. So, yeah, the alligator grabs the two-year-old boy. The father fights with the alligator, trying to get the child back, and he loses. So then they spend the next day trolling this area, setting these traps, trying to find the little boy. You know, there's probably no hope of finding him alive, but they at least want to find his body. They find five alligators. They put four of them down to analyze. And today at roughly 1:45, they discover the body. And so they've got the body out and what have you. The only thing, the only signage around this lake is signs to say no swimming, basically. It doesn't tell you why you shouldn't go in and swim. It just says no swimming.
Right.
There's a map that I saw that showed where this thing is located. There's like this resort, and then there's another part of Disney, and I mean, you know, man-made, hey, it's probably fantastic. What I don't understand, how in the hell do alligators get into a man-made lake?
Yeah, the thing is, do you actually know the history of the land in which that whole area is built upon?
I do not.
It used to be nothing but swampland. Disney bought this huge chunk of swampland that nobody thought anybody was going to do anything with and built his park.
Okay. Well, that kind of makes sense. And, of course, that would be alligators' natural habitat. I do get that. Yeah. But if you're going to be responsible for, you're going to build something like this, and you're going to be responsible for keeping people safe while they have fun and enjoy themselves, yeah. I think you would be going around investigating your man-made lake, your lagoon, and making sure that no creepy crawlies have gotten into the dang thing.
Yeah.
I mean, what are they? Do they do anything? That's my biggest question.
Mm. Yeah.
Or do they just go, here it is, put up some signs. Don't go in the water. Don't go in the water. We don't know what's in there either. Don't go in there.
Which is what a lot of public places that have similar possibilities do, right? They just mm-hmm. say don't swim. I mean, our public park has a thing at the little creek that runs through it that says do not swim. Now, us locals know the reason why you do not want to swim is that quite often snakes and other horrible things are inside that water. But it doesn't say that. It just says don't go swimming. So, yeah, it's one of those things.
Yeah. Well, the family's relieved as much as a family can be relieved when they lose a child. They're relieved to get his body back.
Yeah.
But I was sitting at my desk this afternoon, and I told my wife, I said, Disney's lawyers are probably sitting right now with their sphincters as tight as it possibly can be, because you mark my words, there's going to be a several million, if not $100 million lawsuit that's going to come out of this.
And if this family isn't that type of family, there's some lawyer that's going to try to convince them to be that type of family too.
And, you know, I'm usually on that side saying, you know, don't do a frivolous lawsuit, you know, circumstances, blah, blah, blah. But in this particular instance, I think Disney is culpable. I think they're responsible. And there's no amount of money will ever bring a life back, a child or anything like that. And I do understand that. But there's got to be a way. There's got to be some pain that Disney has to suffer that could. It's not going to equal the pain that that family is suffering from. Yeah, never will. But there's got to be a level of pain that they need to suffer. And if that means several $100 million going to that family, and then if that family decides to do something charitable with it or whatever, that's them. Mm. But there, you know, points have to be made here.
Yeah.
And Disney is responsible, as far as I know right now, and that's my opinion, that they are responsible for this, that they have a responsibility to keep their patrons safe. And simply putting up a sign that says, don't swim, is not it when they got five freaking alligators out of the place.
Yeah, there's the wildlife of Florida is extraordinarily deadly, and they kind of need to know about that at this point. I mean, we have hunts for pythons that could swallow you whole just to make sure that they don't swallow anyone whole. I mean, when stuff like that happens, then you know that you kind of need to pay attention to your park and go, let's try not to let these things in. Yeah.
Yeah. It said, while Tuesday's attack is the first at the Seven Seas Lagoon in 1986, an alligator grabbed an 8-year-old boy between its teeth at Walt Disney World's Fort Wilderness, according to the Orlando Sentinel Archives. Paul Santa Maria of Bristol, New Hampshire, was able to escape with lacerations and puncture wounds after his 10-year-old brother beat the gator with his hands and his 12-year-old sister pulled him out. Mm. The 7-foot-4-inch alligator then slipped back into the pond it had slithered out of. So it's not like they don't know that there's a potential. So, I mean, to me, this is like, When you get word, when the chatter is there's an impending terrorist attack at an event, you up security.
Yeah.
Well, when you know there's an impending alligator attack, you up security. Or you make weekly sweeps and you kill those SOBs. Or if you don't want to do that before animal rights activists come out of the woodworks and want to lynch my ass, relocate them.
Yeah.
You know, if you want to do that, relocate them. I'm not for arbitrarily killing the alligator, because we did invade their habitat. I do understand that. But, you know, we big bad people with big bad weapons, we can kill you. So, but I'd rather they relocate them into somewhere else that they can't be a danger to the patrons.
Because if I'm not mistaken, it's alligators are the more fierce of the two between crocodiles and alligators. Right. I think it's alligators that are the more fierce and more likely to actually attack.
Well, you know, and on top of that, they've had reports in the last few weeks. There have been sightings, not in this area, but other places, I guess, in swamp land of Florida, of these huge alligators, and come to find out, they are not indigenous to Florida. They've actually come from other countries.
Yeah.
Not to make light of it, but how does that happen? You know, you go on Delta's, an alligator goes on Delta's website, gets a ticket, and flies over? I mean, how does that happen?
Garrett Weinzierl actually made a comment about this. It was either him or Justin Robert Young, one of the resident Floridians that I listened to. Let's put it that way, right? But they said chances are those were part of a collector's group of animals that then just got let go, because apparently that happens frequently in Florida. There are people that don't have the most up and up businesses. And decide they suddenly want to be Scarface and have a tiger and everything that. So, yeah, apparently that happens quite frequently. So it's completely possible someone's collection just got released. So
that's not as crazy as the whole, I had a baby alligator and I flushed it down the toilet. And now we've got man gator in the in the sewers in New York or something. So, But, yeah, it's very tragic. My heart goes out to the family. You know, hopefully, like I said, no amount of money will ever replace the life of that child. But I do hope that either Disney steps up and does the right thing and offers some type of compensation, or they find themselves in a big lawsuit and they have to pay out because they should have done a better job.
Mm-hmm.
And I haven't. Go ahead.
I can only pray that they find peace, because this is not going to be, they've lost their son and he was 2 years old. I mean, this isn't something that you just get over. This is something that is going to take a while for them. And I just, pain that they must be going through is unimaginable.
They'll carry it with them for the rest of their lives.
Indeed. Yeah.
And so with the 4 year old daughter, because she probably, you know, as she grows up, she'll have recollections of, she used to have a brother.
Yeah.
And, that's just, I don't wish that kind of pain on anybody.
Right.
Even my worst enemy. Well, maybe my worst enemy. Anyway. But, there is that. Hopefully the rest of the week we'll have at least, you know, baseline, decent, boring news. I mean.
I hope so. This week has just been one of those weeks that happens, right, where you go, what is going on with the world? I don't know.
Yeah, can we have a timeout and do a redo of June, please?
Yeah.
Jeez. All right. Well, Sam, where can you be found? What are you up to? How can people support you in your fantastic content, including those Let's Plays of LEGO Dimensions?
Mm-hmm. If you want to find those, you can go to tscn.tv, and specifically tscn.tv/play if you want to see some examples of LEGO Dimensions in action to find out what the heck I was ranting about. If you want to support my content, maybe you like those Let's Plays and want them to continue, by all means. It sounded like I was holding them up. I wasn't. you donate all these dimension plays die, you see? No, I wasn't doing that. But if you want to support all of the content that we make over there, you can do so at tscn.tv/support to find out how to become a patron of the website. And of course, if you want to find me on my social media links, you can go to about.me/labtech7 to find all of that fun stuff.
That is great. Yes, I am a supporter of Sam's, and you need to be too. And yes, I am holding a gun to his Let's Plays. And, you know, if you don't support him, the Let's Plays gets it, okay? All right, all my stuff that I'm doing is over at slant.fm. Social media is at about.me/gdadkissen. If you got any feedback, the email address is feedback@slant.fm. If you want to leave a voicemail because you didn't feel like calling in during the show or you missed the show or whatever, that number is 313-718-2557. And yes, it's different than the live call-in number. Remember that we record this show live each Monday and Wednesday at 6 p.m. Eastern Time. Have a fantastic week and weekend, and we'll see you next time for another episode of What's. show is a production of the Slant FM Digital Network. Find more at slant.fm.